Let's worship His name and praise Him for the mighty touch of the Holy Ghost that we've already felt in this place today. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise You and we worship You. Amen. You can be seated for a few moments. Amen. So good to see all of you in the house of the Lord today. All of our members and our guests, we're so glad that you're here. Amen. Can you make all of our members and guests welcome today to Bethlehem Church? God bless you. Amen. Thank you for being here. And we're thankful to be in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Already having felt the touch of the Holy Ghost in this place. And just thankful for what the Lord's going to do today. I believe there's still a move of the Holy Ghost this morning and tonight. Amen. God's going to do a great work today, and I'm very excited about what He's going to do. And then, of course, we're looking forward to this week and thankful for the goodness of God and the presence of the Lord. Amen. And I am thankful today to be in an apostolic church. Amen. Where we still preach and teach the apostles' doctrine. Repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name, and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm glad I've been born again the Bible way. Can you give God praise today and thank Him for His mighty presence and power? Amen. We are having first steps for all of our guests and our brand new members. I want to invite all of you, our guests especially, and our new folks that have not gone through first steps. We're having a meal that will be in the new building, and we'll help you get there after service. If you'll see an usher, a greeter, or any of our church family, we can help you get there. We have some exciting things to talk about, and that is first steps, and it is lunch. Lunch is provided. We're looking forward to spending some time with you today. Also, 6 o'clock tonight, we have prayer meeting in the prayer room and church at 6 o'clock, and there is family prayer tomorrow night. And then for the rest of the week, Tuesday through Friday, we have camp meeting, 7 o'clock each night. Brother Matthew Ball is our evening speaker, a great, great preacher, and you'll be blessed by his ministry. And Brother Nate Roberts, everybody calls him Little Nate. And he is doing the children's services this week, and they're going to be fantastic. You will absolutely enjoy it. Can you say amen? I might mention to you that all offerings to the camp meeting should be written to Mississippi District. If you have an offering to the church, bring it today or next Sunday. The only difference is if you write a check for food after the service in the gym, that you can give to the church. They also will take a credit card out there. That's for your information. It saves us having to write a check to the district and them having to write checks back. So if you're going to make an offering to the camp meeting, that will be to the Mississippi District. Amen. I had a great conversation on Friday evening with Brother Scott Strawn. Brother Strawn is our missionary to Ireland. Brother Strawn and his wife are doing an absolutely great work in the country of Ireland. They went several years ago. We had an elder missionary that retired and came off the field. And when this missionary came home, most of the people that were supporting the work in Ireland quit sending their money. And so our new missionaries that were appointed, the Strawns, had a very, very, very difficult time as they were trying to get established and get moved. And I don't think it's a stretch to say that they suffered greatly. Because of laws, they weren't able to find other ways to get income. And they really, really paid a price. As a matter of fact, at one point, I think the missions board was ready to bring them home because their basic needs were not being met. But they were committed, and they said, we're going to stay whatever it takes, whatever it costs, we're going to stay. And to make a long story short, God has answered with revival. Amen. They have baptized a denominational pastor, and he's baptizing his people in Jesus' name. They're baptizing 4 people, I believe, this weekend, 2 more coming up later this week. And God is granting a great revival in Ireland, so much so that they are They are opening a second church. Amen. The church in Waterford is the one they've been doing, but they are opening a second church in another city where God has given them a lot of people that they're baptizing, and God is moving in a mighty way in that city. And this coming week, the camp meeting missions offering that we take every Thursday is going to go to help them. They have to get 2 years' rent. They have to have 2 years' rent in advance for them to get their building. It's $27,000 American dollars. And we're the Mississippi District is going to help with as much of that as possible. And on Thursday night, we're going to be receiving a missions offering. And that offering I got, they always give me the job of raising the money for the missions offering. They always give that to me. And so I talked to Brother Strawn on Friday, and I went online a few days ago and I ordered a bunch of Irish flags. And if I sell all of these flags at $75 each, then the Mississippi District can do our half of their rent. Amen. Praise God. They already have people lined up to be baptized. And if you want to be a part of that, I've got the flags. I'll sell them to you today. I'm not really selling the flags. The flags are just something you can remember to pray. What I'm really trying to do is sell you on being part of the kingdom of God and helping win souls. And if you want to be a part of that, I got them in my office. You can write a check for the missions offering. And look, if you want to give, there's people here. You can give a lot more than that. I've already bought many flags worth myself. I've already committed to it. But I think we can do it, and I want to be a part of it. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. I tell you what I've learned. I've learned that there is a blessing in giving to missions. Because when I give to other things, that a lot of that benefit stays right here. It's almost like giving to myself in a certain sense. When I give to something here, and I'm not trying to talk people out of giving to the church, but I'm just telling that when I give to missions, I know that I'm not going to get anything personal out of that. There's no personal investment. It's all about the kingdom. And when you start investing in the kingdom, then it gets God's attention and God takes notice. And I believe that God is going to do a great work. So I want you to be praying about that. Amen. I want to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, and I want to be a part of making disciples. Amen. Praise the Lord. The book of John, chapter number 4, in just a moment, as you're standing with me, I want to say thank you to all the people that have worked so hard. There's been a lot of people working inside and outside, and just a lot of effort that's been going into getting ready for camp meeting. I hope that you will take advantage of the opportunity that we have for God to do a great work. We have people that are intricately involved in ministries, multiple ministries here at the church, that got the Holy Ghost in camp meeting. And I'm thankful for that. And for everyone that's worked, I say thank you. Amen. Brother Benny Connor is out working right now, as a matter of fact. But he has worked tirelessly, and there's been a lot of people help him. And I just want to say thank you. That's right. Go ahead and give them all a good hand. Give yourselves a good hand. Amen. There's a large percentage of our church that will get nothing out of the services at camp meeting, because they'll be working in different areas and serving in different areas. And those of you that are in the services, I know you're going to be blessed. There's some that won't be in any service all week long because they're working, and I believe that God's going to add a blessing to them and to be able to be a part of helping other people touch God. Thank you for that. Amen. The book of John, chapter number 4. The book of John, chapter number 4, verses 3 through 11. Amen. I left Thursday morning and went to Brazil, preached, had three church services. One of them I didn't get to preach. They shouted me out. One of them I did preach. I had five baptized in Jesus' name. Amen. But it was Brazil, Indiana. Thank God. Hallelujah. Nonetheless, I was in Brazil. John chapter number 4 and verse number 3. On June the 23rd, I preached from this passage of Scripture, a message titled, You Are the Answer. I will not do much of the background to that I preached in that message. You're welcome to go on SoundCloud and YouTube and Facebook Live and archive and look at that. I will tell you that this week, and this is to brag on our camera people and our video personnel, our computer people that operate all that stuff, the sound people, all of the projection and all of those folks. I had a pastor that came up to me, and he watches almost every one of our services. And then it was a little bit after that, there was a new convert couple, just got in church over the last couple of years, and they came up to me while I was eating, and my neck has been sore. I don't know what's happened, but I've been sore. So they stood over my shoulder, so I wanted to just say, come over here. And they're probably watching now, so praise the Lord. God bless you. But they start saying, what's first steps? Talk to me about Grow Class. What's Grow 1 and Grow 2? Talk to me about life groups. And what I'm saying is to all of you people that work, there's people that are right now, they're going to be so mindful about what's going on from their job that they're not going to get anything out of the service this morning other than the blessing of God. But somebody out there is going to be touched and ministered to because people are willing to serve. That's part of being a disciple and making disciples. It takes all of it to make it happen. So praise the Lord. John chapter number 4, verse number 3. John chapter number 4, verse number 3 through verse 11. Amen. I hope my preaching is not as wordy as my announcements. And you do too. He left Judea and departed again into Galilee. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar. Four locations already given: Judea, Galilee, Samaria, Sychar. Near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Let me back up to verse number 7 and point something out. There cometh a woman of Samaria. Why was she there? To draw water. And Jesus said, Give me to drink. Disciples gone away to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. And Jesus answered and said unto her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, Give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. I'm probably going to forget to preach this, but you cannot miss the fact that he was not going to give living water unless she asked for it. All right? If you would have asked of him, and if you would ask, he would give you living water. May I tell you, there are miracles and blessings in the house of God today. But he is not going to throw it at you. But if you'll ask him, he'll give you living water today. Then the woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? The well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? I'm drawing a subject today from the seventh verse where the Bible said, there cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. And my title is Getting More Than You Came For. Getting More Than You Came For. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water, but she got more than she came for. God, I pray for your anointing on me to preach. God, I pray, let the word find good ground in our hearts. Anoint our ears to hear what the Spirit would say. I pray, God, not by power, not by might, but by your Spirit, let the anointing of the Holy Ghost destroy yokes in this place. In the name of Jesus, we pray, God. I pray that you help the church to say amen. And I pray that you help me to preach your word. Help us to work together for a move of the Holy Ghost in this place, that somebody can get more than they came for. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise today. God bless you. You can be seated. When children are born, they bring joy and hope into the future of a family. For months before my daughters were born, I would pray for them. I prayed that they would be healthy, and I prayed that they would use their talents for the Lord. I prayed that they would be sensitive to the Spirit of God. I prayed that they would love prayer, that they would love the Lord, that they would have a heart that God could touch. I prayed that they would love the truth and that they would walk in holiness. And I prayed that they would love to work in the kingdom of God. I would put my hand on my wife's belly and I would say things like, God, don't let my children ever think it's okay to just sit on a pew and not be working in the kingdom of God. I prayed that they would be soul winners. I prayed every prayer I could think of to pray over them while they were yet in the womb. And I remember the night that Ellie was born. After that day, we had church on Sunday night, and about 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the morning, we headed up to the hospital in Memphis. And that evening, or late afternoon, Ellie was finally born. And she'd been late arriving her whole life. But that's a different, that doesn't belong in the sermon. But I remember her being born. And that the very night that she was born, I remember holding her in my arms and thinking about her life. And I cried when I thought about her graduating high school and getting married. The night she was born, I cried about her getting married. I held her in my arms, and I had hopes and dreams for her life. No parent holds their baby and says, I hope that she'll end up an adulterer or a fornicator. I hope history will remember her as the woman of ill repute. No parent holds their babies and dreams about broken lives and broken relationships. Little girls dream of being princesses and ballerinas. They dream of their wedding days. I'm going to tell you, weddings are my least favorite part about being a pastor. We got a couple of weddings coming up. I'm not talking about you personally. I'm just saying, no one sits around when they're 6 years old and writes out every detail of their funeral. Nobody at 9 years old dreams of their burial dress. But I mess up one thing in a wedding and I've ruined a dream. Little girls dream of being princesses and ballerinas and they dream of their wedding days. Everybody all right? No little girl dreams about being shuttled from man to man and house to house. No little girl dreams of being hated by other women. No little girl dreams of being the object of nothing but a primal desire without compassion or love or even friendship. But this woman we read about in John chapter number 4 was the epitome of a broken dream and lost hope. She became what no parent wants their little girl's life to be like. She lived a daily existence that no little girl dreams of having. For her, life had not turned out like she had hoped. She was hated by the other women and disrespected by the men. This woman from John chapter number 4 has been remembered for thousands of years simply as the woman of ill repute. The kinder term, if people are in the mood to be nice, they simply call her the woman at the well. She was known by her choice of lifestyle. Her parents were probably devastated at how their little girl's life turned out. She never intended her life to be this way. The woman is a bundle of lost hope and shattered dreams. Life just didn't seem to work out for her. I wonder this morning if there's anybody in this house today. You don't have to say amen right here, and you certainly don't have to nod your head or raise your hand. But I wonder if there's somebody that can identify with the sense of life just didn't turn out how I thought it might. My life hasn't gone the way I planned it. Things haven't exactly gone according to the script. I'm not saying that you can identify with her lifestyle, but I am raising the question if maybe the life you're living is not the life you thought you would live. All right? You hoped that maybe it would be different than it is. You never dreamed that life would be like it is for you from day to day. You don't have to be a person of ill repute to have lost hopes and broken dreams. Amen. Amen. Maybe someone here this morning has felt that life somehow took a turn and it's not what you had hoped that it would be. I've come today to preach to somebody about hope. Broken dreams and shattered dreams do not have to be the end of the story. Praise God. I preached, like I said, on June the 23rd, on Sunday morning, and I'm not going to go back and preach a lot of the background that I preached that morning, but I'll encourage you, if you want to go back and try to find that. But I will tell you that it was about the sixth hour of the day that it was high noon on the Jewish clock. All the other ladies had gone to the well early in the morning, before the hot sun had risen. But this lady avoided the criticism and the hostility of the women who hated her for her lifestyle, for the homes that she had wrecked. Apparently, the heat of the sun was much less painful than the treatment of the other people. So she approached what she hoped would be an empty place. But notice that there was a Jewish man sitting on the well. And when she sees him and recognizes that he is not a Samaritan, he is a Jew, she knows in her mind, this man is no friend of mine. This man views Samaritans as dogs. They hate us. They hate who we are. They hate what our ancestors have done. And they hate Samaritans. And now I've come to the well to draw water, but instead of just drawing water, now I'm going to be criticized. I'm going to be mocked. I'm going to be talked down to. I'm going to be looked down on. And I've come to just draw water, but now I'm going to have to put up with the ostracization of this person. I'm going to have to put up with their hatred. I'm going to have to put up with their bias. And now I came just to get water, but now I'm going to have to be mistreated. She didn't know that this was no ordinary Jew sitting on the well. This was not any old Jewish man. This was Jesus of Nazareth. She didn't know that Jesus had made a detour just to have the opportunity to meet her. He went out of his way for one person. He left Judea to go to Galilee. Amen. The word Judea is a Hebrew word that means he shall be praised. It is a land of praise. It means that God is going to be praised. He left a place where it was designed for God to be worshiped, to go to a place known as Galilee. Galilee means the heathen circle. He left the place of praise to go to the heathen circle. He left a place where people would worship to go to a place where people were heathens. I'm glad that God is not only interested in the worshiper, but he's also interested in the people who have issues and trials and problems in their life. If he didn't go to the heathen circle, none of us would be here today. If he wasn't interested in going out of his way to find people who had issues, then not one of us would be in this house today. I know most of us, many of us have been here for a long time. We've been in church. We've been around church for so long that maybe we've forgotten what it was like when our life was in chaos and when our life was a mess. But I'm still thankful that I remember that God still goes to the heathen circle, even if it's just for one person. Oh, hallelujah. He leaves Judea to go to Galilee, and then when in Galilee, he goes to Samaria. Samaria was the capital of the northern kingdom during the Israeli Civil War. It represented sedition and rebellion. It was hated and reviled. They had set up their own temple to bypass the temple at Jerusalem. Samaria represented rebellion against God and rebellion against authority. But God, Jesus Christ, manifest in the flesh, is willing to go to where the rebels are. Amen. He's willing to go to where people are in rebellion against him and his word. I'm glad that God still goes to people who aren't lined up with his word because he cares enough about them to go out of his way. He'll leave a land of praise to go to the heathen to find the rebel. Somebody ought to praise him. Somebody that's been in that condition ought to thank him right now. Somebody that was a heathen and a rebel against God and his word, you ought to praise God that he goes out of his way for people just like me and you. I was preaching somewhere recently, and I was preaching to the church in another state, which I've been in a lot of other states this summer, preaching camp meetings and different events. And I remember I was in one particular service preaching to the church, preaching to saved people. And while I was preaching, two people who were obviously far from God, they walked in the back doors of that building and they walked down an aisle. They didn't just stop at the back. They came to like the second or third row. And I watched while I was preaching as the eyes of the people in that building began to follow them. And at that moment, I changed my message. Because now I realize those people need God. And Jesus goes out of his way. Sometimes he'll leave the worshiper. He'll leave Judea to go to Galilee, to the heathen. He'll go through to Samaria where people are in rebellion to him and his word, just to find somebody that's thirsty, that needs to hear from God. Oh, Lord Jesus, God help me this morning. Amen. I'm going to tell you, I'm glad that he left Judea to go to Galilee, to pass through Samaria, to find somebody that was like me, that needed him, that he wasn't only concerned with the ones with the Bible under their arm, but he looked for the one who needed God. That's what he did for this woman. That's what he did for this lady. And I'll tell you, that's what he did for me when I was in rebellion to him, when I was away from him, and I was far from him. He went out of his way to find me as a teenager that was cold and distant from him. Thank God that he goes out of his way for sinners. I wish somebody would praise him. I wish somebody could get a memory of what it used to be like. So he leaves Judea, goes to Galilee, goes through Samaria, comes to a place called Sychar. Sychar is a word that means to become drunk. It means to drink until you become happy or merry. It has the implication that you've got some sadness and sorrow, some brokenness that you're trying to forget about, that there's some issues in your life that you have that you need to cover up with some kind of something else, because life hasn't treated you like you thought it would, because life hasn't turned out. So this word Sychar means to become intoxicated or drunk. It was to cover the anguish and the pain of life. And wow, so you got to think about it. Jesus leaves the place where everybody's worshiping to go to the land of the heathen, to go through where people are rebellious, to come to a place where they're thirsty and trying to drown out the cares of life. Jesus went way out of his way to find one person that needed him at the well. I'm going to tell you, if God designed this entire service for just one person, that would be fine with me. Amen. If he bypassed all the rest of us who think we're okay, who think we don't need him, who think everything's fine, if I get a touch from God today or not, I'm fine. I'll walk out and I'll go about my life. If he'll bypass everybody for that one person that says, I need something to happen to my life. My life needs God. I need a turnaround. If he'll do that, God, come on. If it's just one person today that needs you. But I got a feeling there's more than one person that needs God to help them today. There's some more than one person that came in with the burden, with the care, with the worry, with the trial. And you came and you said, God, I need an answer. I need a touch. I need your help. I've got good news. He's coming to this place. He's coming to the well. It's interesting that she comes to this place possibly to find something to cover the pain and anguish of her life, just long enough to get a little bit of joy, a little bit of merriment out of it, just a little bit of happiness for just a brief moment. And now my moment of respite is ruined because there's somebody that hates me sitting on the well, but he doesn't hate her. She thought he hated her. She assumed because of who he was that he would want nothing to do with somebody like her. And I'm going to tell you, there's people all over the world. There's people all over who think because of their life and the mistakes that they've made and the things that they've done, that there's no way that God could love them and that God could care. So she walks up to the well with her defense mechanism already engaged, but expecting for her to be rebuked by this Jewish man on the well. But instead of a rebuke, she finds that he cares about her and he loves her. And may I tell you that there may be people here today that because of the things in your life, you come to the house of God and you expect to be rebuked again. But I've come to tell you, Jesus has come to this place today to accept you and to give you water and to allow you to be changed by the power of his mercy and his grace. To her, she was just going to the well to draw water. It's what the Bible said. She went to the well to draw water, just doing her normal routine. She didn't know that God had arranged to meet her that day. Just going through the same old routine, and maybe it's just your routine to come to church, and it's just the habit, it's the Sunday morning thing, and it's what you do, and you really had no plan for anything else to transpire today. You just came to draw water and go home, but you didn't know that maybe God had designed a moment to revolutionize your entire life. God may have made a detour today just to find you. I wish somebody would help me preach this morning. I'm not going to keep you too much longer, I don't think. She approached the well expecting hostility, but she got more than what she came for. Because he said, "Give me to drink." He initiated a conversation with her. And that initiation of conversation did not begin with an insult. It didn't begin with some kind of a snide remark. It was a simple request, "Give me to drink." And she's amazed. She says, "How is it that you, being a Jew, would ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. You're not even supposed to be talking to me. If you're not going to be mean, you should at the very least ignore me. But here you are engaging me in conversation." And then he says, "Woman, if you knew the gift of God." You ever knew somebody that thought they were God's gift to women? He thought he was God's gift to women, sinners, sick, weary, tired, depressed, discouraged, men, women, children, babies. He thinks he's the answer to everybody. And you know what? He is the answer to everybody. He said, "If you knew the gift of God, I wouldn't have got a chance. If you knew what was available to you right now, I wouldn't have even got the chance to ask you for a drink of water. You would have walked up to the well and you would have asked me first." I'm going to tell you, there is so much spiritual power available for somebody's life in this place today that there should never be a moment where God has to say, "Come on, would you worship me? Come on, would you reach out to me? Come on, would you love me?" There ought to be such a faith when we walk through the doors of this church. Jesus is here and we're asking for living water. He said, "If you would have known what's available," and I've come to tell you, it is a gift and it is available for you today. There's hope for your marriage, hope for your family, hope for your children, hope for your mind, hope for your body, hope for your soul, hope for your finances. There's hope for your business. There's hope for your marriage. There's hope for your life, and it's all here. And he's waiting for you to say, "Give me a drink of water." But your worship is how you engage him. You knew the gift of God and who it was that asked you for a drink, you would have asked of him and he would have given thee living water. When Jesus said, "I would have given thee living water," that was not a phrase that was lost on the moment, because in Jewish law, cleansing to take place, it had to be done with living water. It couldn't be from a cistern. Water from a cistern would not do. All purification had to be made with living water. So when Jesus said that he would give her living water, what he was saying is, "I can wash away the stains of your life. I can wash away the pain of your failures. I can wash away the stain of your sin. I can wash away all the problems of your life. all the stuff you've got yourself into, all the brokenness, all the hurt, all the emptiness, all the mess, all the I can wash it all, because when I give living water purifies everything. Amen. What he's saying is, I know what you've come in here with. I know what you've done. I know how you've lived. I know all the mess you've got. And here's what I'm offering. I'm offering living water that will cleanse all of that and wash it all away. And when he said, I would have given thee living water, what he's saying is, I'll wash you today. And when you leave the well, you won't be like you were anymore. I've come to tell somebody, it does not really matter what you brought in. If you'll let living water flow on you, you can go home washed, cleansed, renewed, refreshed, revived, brand new. My God in heaven, somebody ought to shout right now, because there's living water available in the house of God. She couldn't quite grasp the spiritual application yet. She was not able to think spiritually because of all the things binding her life. And I pray right now that that people would be able to understand the offer that God is giving them today. To the average reader, this woman made a very benign statement in verse number 11. She said, sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living? Where are you going to get this water from? The well is deep. This particular well is 110 feet deep. It's a long way down to the water. And she looks at him and she realizes he has no rope, he has no bucket, he has nothing to draw with. You have nothing that can help me. I've come for water. You're offering me water, but you don't have anything that can help me. You don't have a rope. You don't have a bucket. You don't have a cup. You don't have anything that can help me get my water. How are you going to help me? From whence then hast thou that living water? What are you going to do? How are you going to help me? How are you going to get it? Are you greater than Jacob that dug the well? Are you better than the one that dug the well in the first place? How are you going to help me? You got nothing to help me with. And there's people that look at the church and they look at God and they think, you don't have anything that can really help my life. You don't have anything that can turn my life around. You don't have anything that can fix my past. You don't have anything that can pull my family back together. You don't have anything to help my children. You don't have anything to help my sanity. You have nothing to draw with. And they look and they think that the church is empty-handed, but what they don't understand is that the church does not deal in the natural. The church deals in the spiritual. Amen. And the water that he was giving was not natural water, but it was spiritual water. Can I preach just a few more minutes and get out of your way? Amen. She looks at him. He said, I would have given thee living water. She said, you don't have anything to draw with. You're just another man breaking another promise to me. You're just another man promising me everything and not being able to deliver one more time. You're like everybody else that said that you would give me something and then you just leave me broken and empty. That's what she's thinking. You've offered me living water and you don't have anything to help me. You're like all the other people that have ever promised me anything and left me with nothing. You have nothing to draw with. You can't rescue me. You can't help me. She uses a word in her discourse. She uses a Greek word, ferar. When she says well, it is actually the Greek word ferar. The well is deep. The ferar is deep. It is literally, it means a well, and it also means an abyss or a prison or a pit. The prison is deep. And you have nothing to draw with. The pit that I'm in is deep and you got nothing to help me. The abyss that I've fallen into is deep and you've got absolutely nothing that can help me. And there's some people that feel like their lives are so far in the pit that there's no way it'll ever recover. And that's what she said. The Farrar is deep. The prison is deep and you can't help me. I've dug such a hole in my life that you can't get me out of it. I've had 5 husbands. Every relationship I've ever had has been bad. Everything I've ever tried to do has fallen apart. Everything in my life has been ruined. I have no reputation. I have no hopes. I have no dreams left. I have no relationship. Everything I have is a prison or an abyss, and you can't turn my life around. How are you going to get that living water for me? How are you going to put my life back together? How are you going to fix my reputation? How in the world are you going to take my life and make it worth living again? You've got nothing to draw with. In verse number 13, Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. In my mind, he's pointing down that 110-foot well. And he tells her something she already knows. If you drink of this water, you're going to thirst again. If you get this water, you'll be back here tomorrow because you're going to be thirsty again. If you drink of this water, it's going to be empty. Y'all awake this morning? You okay? If you take this drug again, you're going to need another hit of it tomorrow. If you try to fill this pit in your life with a relationship, you're going to need another relationship tomorrow. If you try to fix it out of a bottle, you're going to need to get another bottle tomorrow. If you're looking in the pit of this world for your solution to your answer, I've got bad news. Tomorrow you're going to be in the same place you were today. You're going to be in the same place next week that you are today. I'm telling somebody, if you keep going to the same answers you've always gone to, you're going to be in the same pit tomorrow that you're in today. And you'll be in the same pit next year that you're in today. But I've come to tell you there is living water available today. There's living water available. He said, if you drink of this water, you'll thirst again. But if you drink of the water that I'll give, you'll never thirst again. He's making an eternal offering today. He's making an eternal offer this morning. You can have a solution to your problem. You can have a quenching for your thirst. Can I preach one more point to you? He said, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him. What I'm doing, I'm not giving you an outside source, I'm giving you an inside source. You don't have to walk to the well anymore. You don't have to walk to the liquor store anymore. You don't have to walk to the crack house anymore. You don't have to walk to the meth dealer anymore. You don't have to walk to the arms of a lover again. I'm going to put something inside of you, and it's a well of living water. But when he said well, when he said the word well, he didn't say the word Farrar. When he said the word well, he didn't say, I'm going to put a pit inside of you. I'm going to put an abyss inside of you. I'm going to put a prison in. No, no, no. I'm going to tell you, living for God is not a prison. Holiness is not a prison. Clean living is not a prison. When he said, I'll put a well in you, he used the Greek word, pege, which is a fountain of joy and a fountain of love and a fountain of water. He said, I'm going to take your prison and I'm going to put a fountain inside of you that springs up. It's going to keep on springing, and it's going to keep on springing, and it's going to keep on springing. Oh, somebody ought to bring your Farrar and take your Pege. You ought to bring your prison and you ought to take your fountain. You ought to bring your abyss and you ought to take your well home today. That's what he's offering. That's what he's offering today. You can leave with more than you came for.
You can leave with more than you came for. You can leave with more than you came for. You may have came just looking for a religious experience, but you can leave with a fountain in your soul that springs up. Oh, God. Somebody ought to throw your hands to heaven and say like the woman did, "Sir, give me this water that I thirst not." She finally asked the question. The question she should have asked in verse number 13. She finally asked it in verse number 15. "Sir, give me this water." He will not force it on you. He will not throw it at you. He will not command you to take it. But if you'll say, "Give me this water," you can be baptized in Jesus' name. You can be filled with the Holy Ghost. You can be touched by the power of God. And it springs up.
If I had time, I'd preach about the different kinds of wells that there are. Because there's groundwater. And groundwater is easily contaminated. And it can easily be dried out by the sun. You can have groundwater today and it'll be gone tomorrow. And that's the way the world is. You can get a little bit today and tomorrow it'll be gone. And it's easily contaminated. Then there's surface wells. It's called an unconfined aquifer. And you don't have to dig deep for it. It's shallow, but it's also, not only is it shallow, but it also has a lot of dirt and a lot of stuff in it. And you can have that kind of a shallow touch today if you want to. But then there's something called an artesian well. And an artesian well is pure in a confined underground aquifer. And that artesian well has pure, clean water, but you still have to dig for it. But then Jesus, he didn't say, what he said is, "I'm going to give you a well that springs up into everlasting life." And that is a flowing artesian well or a springing artesian well. And that means that underground where that water is confined within the rock. Amen. It's nestled in the rock so contaminants can't get to it. But that water inside of that rock, there is pressure that builds up. And that pressure, when all of a sudden, when that well is tapped into, the pressure that's inside causes that water to shoot up out. And when that water shoots out, it can't be stopped. And Jesus said, if you'll come to the rock and you'll let me touch you, that water will spring up from inside of you. And there's nothing going to be able to stop it. The devil can't stop it. The enemy can't stop it. Addiction can't stop it. Hell can't stop it. The world can't stop it. And when you get it, it's going to flow out. And it's going to flow tomorrow and the next day and the next day and the next day. I'm glad. Look, when I got the Holy Ghost as a little boy, it's still flowing today. It's still good. Is the Holy Ghost still good? I watched him a while ago with his hands up, worshiping God. He's got those long arms, it looks like he could change the light bulbs. But I watched him worship God, and I remembered when he got the Holy Ghost a few months ago, and it still flows. I said it still flows. I'm glad. I've got it. There's something about the power of the Holy Ghost. I can't explain it, but I've got it. It's still good. It's still real. It's still powerful. Hey, you can get more than you came for today. Sir, give me this water. Sir, give me this water. Give me this water. Give me this water that I thirst not. You can go home dry, or you can lift your face to heaven and say, "Sir." Somebody ought to do it right now. You ought to open your mouth and let the Holy Ghost fill it. There ought to be tongue talking all over this place. There ought to be one God apostolic folks. There ought to be sinner folks. There ought to be visitor folks. Everybody ought to say, "Sir, give me this water. It's a springing up well. It's a springing up well." Thank you.
I said it still makes me want to shout. It still puts a shout in my feet. It's, my God, I don't know how you're standing there. My well's about to bubble over. I don't know how you can take it, because what I feel up here, it's still real. It's still good. It's living water. It's living water. It's living water. Somebody ought to open their mouth right now. You ought to open your mouth and praise to God, because He didn't give you a shallow well. He didn't give you a contaminated well. He gave you a well springing up. Come on, somebody ought to open your mouth. You ought to open your mouth and you ought to yell out in the Holy Ghost. You ought to give a praise to God. You ought to leave with more than you came for. Everybody ought to leave with more than you came for. You ought to throw your hands up and open your mouth. There ought to be some tongue talking going on in here. There ought to be some aisle running, some shouting, some tongue talking in this place, because I'm leaving with more than I came for. It's real, it's real. I know it's real. I said it's real, it's real. I know it's real. It's that Pentecostal blessing, and I know it's real. Come on, you ought to lay hands on somebody. You ought to grab them by the hand and shout a while. You ought to do something. You ought to do something, because there's a flowing well in this place. Open your mouth and talk in tongues. Open your mouth and speak it out. Open your mouth and let the joy flow through you. Open your mouth and begin to let the Lord bless you. Lay a hand on him. Take authority as a mama and pray the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus. Come on, spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well. I release joy in the Holy Ghost. I release peace in the Holy Ghost. I release deliverance in the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus. The Holy Ghost moving here right now. Somebody's got to break out of the normal routine. Somebody's got to break out of the routine and the rut and go ahead and push yourself to another level of praise right now. And you can leave with more than you came for, but you're going to have to press out.
Thank you.
you just take somebody by the hand and begin to worship God with them. Men, put your hand on somebody's shoulder, begin to pray with them, praise God with them. Hallelujah. Spring up, oh well. Let a wave of revival sweep through our families. Let the water of heaven begin to flow. I'm telling you, there is regeneration, there is restoration, there is renewal, there is revival, there's fresh anointing, there's fresh fire. Come on, somebody. I'm telling you, it's here, it's here. If you knew the gift of God, I shouldn't have had to give an altar call. You ought to just go ahead right now and open your mouth and say, flood me with the Holy Ghost.
Thankful for the refreshing of living water this morning. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we thank you for living water, God. Oh, I worship you and I praise you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Aren't we thankful for our leadership and giving their gifts, their talents to the work of the kingdom? We're so blessed at Bethlehem. We should always let them know. They're fighting for us. And I thank the Lord for leaders that are sensitive to the needs of his people. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Remember First Steps, guests and visitors over in the new building. If you need direction, ask somebody. We could lead you to the cafeteria in the new building. And camp meeting this week. Remember, there's no classes today, no ministry class, no Bible study. But come early this evening for prayer. And let's have another move of God and get another drink from the well at Bethlehem. Amen. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, I pray a blessing upon everyone in here, God, that they not leave this room with any dry place, God, that you desire to touch, God, but that that well would begin to overflow and they would begin to become even more sensitive to what you're doing in their lives, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing, God. To you be the glory, the honor, and the praise. Bring your tithes to the storehouse and be dismissed in Jesus' mighty name. Remember your Bibles, to take your Bibles today. Don't leave them on the pew. They'll be misplaced.